And welcome back. We're moving into our final discussion for today, and we've been joined by representatives from the Belize Police Department. We have the PR officer, Douglas Hyde, and we also have the officer in charge of community policing for Precinct 3, Wilfredo Petillo. Good morning, gentlemen.
Good morning. Welcome.
Thanks. Of course, this was an initiative that we started talking a couple of months ago.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And it's now right around the corner. So let's start talking about BLACK and what it stands for and how it has been unfolding with time.
The acronym BLACK, B-L-A-C-K, originated, of course, from Senior Superintendent of Police, Mr. Edward Braster. Shortly after we did our first health walk last year, ending of last year, Mr. Braster saw where the communities and the police, again, as a community-oriented policing initiative, can do something immediately afterwards of continuing that momentum of working with the community. He came up with the idea of BLACK, which means be loving and cease killing, as the dub for this initiative, because of the increase of the crime and violence in the communities. See, some people feel like the police officers are only tasked in doing investigation and, of course, looking on the era of protecting individuals when it comes to crime and violence. Mm-hmm. But as human beings, each police officer, when somebody gets shot or killed, also feels it. And many times in our discussion, police officers will share their feelings and emotions likewise when somebody get killed, especially in these hot spots that we know in the neighborhoods. And Mr. Braster thought it would be good for the police to take an initiative of saying here what we want to coordinate with communities, with businesses, schools, in terms of doing a walk, a march around these areas as we know it as the hot spots communities. And in that initiative, to bring out the community to show that we are all in this in efforts of fighting crime. And it's not just a police dealing with the issue of crime and violence, but a community initiative in sending that message to those persons who feel that they can take control of the communities with their crime and violence initiative mentality. So the police, we've looked at many initiatives, and this is one to say we want the community, we want the businesses, the organizations, such as the schools, to join us in terms to walk in solidarity against crime and violence.
Let me bring it over to Wilfredo a bit, because what Douglas is speaking of is something I'm sure that resonates with you, being in the community policing. You guys go out, you know the families in your areas, you know the children, the parents, the grandparents, so you know how they're living and the impact that the loss of a life makes. Having seen within particular Erin in Precinct 3 where you are, the murders that have taken place, the gang warfare, how has it affected the community and by extension the community policing officers?
Well, actually, crime and violence affect Precinct 3 precinct significant, especially when it triggers in the south side. It has a ripple effects on the north side. Mm-hmm. And as a result, everyone have that fear. And we as community policing officer, we try to go out there and try to sympathize with the community and try to assure them that yes, the police will be there to make the community safer. Mm-hmm.
Now, what's your kind of engagement with the families? I mean, generally it's after something has happened. Now you're talking about having an initiative where you get people to talk about this and to actually take action before anything unfolds. What has been the conversation like with families and people living in the community?
As you can see, for the past months and even a couple of years, the whole community-oriented policing strategy have changed the whole dynamics of the police department. Rather than always reacting when a crime happens, we are more proactive. And now we've even moved to a different stage of being coactive, meaning that we're working more with the communities. So we've already adapted that philosophy and principle of getting to the families and getting to the communities before some crimes happen. It's a pity that whether or not we've done that groundwork, crime still occurs. And what we're trying to do is try our best to decrease these areas of crime and have more community as the well-known Sir Robert Peel, in his comment as a statement to say that the community is the police and the police is the community. What we want to do now is to have communities take more ownership. You know, I'm starting to just rely on the police to deal with certain things, and we are there to support. And we, of course, we'll do our part, but we need more communities to pull out that sense of ownership to say, this is our community. We now make a couple handful of guys do what they want to do and run this area. We want to run it. So the police is there to give that support, and we are there before, and with our community policing initiatives such as the Neighborhood Watch programs, the cadet programs, and these different programs that we run are more proactive, that we are with the families, talking to them to get their kids involved in certain things. For example, this weekend, for the first time, we'll be in the Band Fest, where the cadets, for the first time, will be participating, not just by scene initiative, but actually participating in the Band Fest itself.
Now, this approach that you speak of is one that we have obviously seen the Belize Police Department make an effort to, that community policing isn't reserved for just community policing officers or those assigned to the units, but more so having the approach be across the board. What has been the reaction of the different officers? Because it is very different from going in and doing a search or a stop and search versus going out and meeting a family. The approach is completely different.
The operational side of the department will never change, because that itself is one of the motto within the structures of the police department. But what we are trying to do and what we are doing is to make all police officers community-oriented police officers.
Yeah.
Which means that they go through that basic training, and based on the principles and the philosophy, that they adapt it within their day-to-day work. Meaning simple approach, simple way of how you talk to persons are very, very critical, which we call PR, which is part of community policing. Very much important, your day-to-day work of how you deliver yourself. Basic things as the steps to get the work done. Those are all in terms of the community-oriented policing. What we're saying is that police officers cannot do the work by themselves. They need the community.
Yeah.
And so that is very important, that even each police officer understand that on a day-to-day basis, that when the crime committed, is the community you need to go back to do your investigation and your support.
Can I just follow up on that? Because it's so important. I believe the last time you were here, something came to mind. As children, you learn who community workers are. You learn the friendly faces of the people who help you. There were your firefighters, there were your policemen, there are your doctors and nurses and teachers. I know, and I think I can say with some certainty, that as children get older, because of some of the things we've been seeing in our society, they don't see police as community workers as much as was the case when they were perhaps preschoolers. So how do you work to become that trustworthy, friendly person who will be able to protect me in time of needs, rather than the police to come, go run, go hide, or be careful?
Yeah. I've seen over the past years through our programs, specifically our cadet, the Do the Right Thing programs, which works more closely with young people and children, have literally showed some positive responses when it comes to young people and the police. I will tell you that it's not all young persons who dislike police or have a anger or hurt about police. Majority of young people love police officers. In fact, you're hearing by our intake, our examinations, every year police examinations, the number of young people over the age of 18 that goes for examinations grows every year. Our last exam was almost 900 persons who went and take that exam. And of that, of course, there's only 100 spaces, 150 spaces. That itself says something about our young people in terms of interest about becoming a police officer. If we continue in this aspect, which we continue emphasize the whole principle of community policing, we see our young people more and more becoming more attached to police officers and the work they do. I think police officers have a wonderful job in terms of day-to-day delivery. Mm-hmm. What have happened is that people only see the operational part, the part when they have to be that firm and professional person in getting the work done. But they are just like the community workers. They get in there and they have
to
answer questions,
workers.
You know what I'm saying? They are like the social workers. In fact, many times police officers play the mother and father in circumstances when there is no adult there. And so that support is there. Black is one of the initiatives to say, here, what we need that support.
Yeah.
We need that support from the community, and we continue to reach out to the community in getting that.
Now, one of the things, obviously, from a PR standpoint, you know, you can talk about the philosophy behind this, but what has changed within the engagement in and the training that policemen to a rethinking of those on the to encourage a rethinking in terms of those who are already in the force, and to get them to understand that they're a part of a community and to act accordingly?
William, to be honest, it's not easy. There's a culture already there. And I could tell people the police department is not just saying that, oh, it's community policing, so everybody's on the board.
Yeah.
It is a culture. And for the past years, community policing have come a long way within the department. In the next couple of weeks and months, the commissioner will officially launch the community policing manual. And that, based on his directive, basically, is to say that it's not just a unit. It's not just these trained community policing officers. It's everybody within the police department will adopt the philosophy and principle. The culture is tough and challenging, but what we have done is to achieve great steps when it comes to police officers themselves being trained, but understanding the philosophy and the principles. And I think PC Petillo is one of many officers before they actually been placed in community policing. Their thinking was one way when it comes to crime and violence and how to deal with the situation compared to how they address the situation from a proactive mentality now.
Yeah. Tell us about that.
Well, actually, from the age of 10, I was in the Belize Police U Cadet Corps, climbing up my rank, being in charge in Orange Drop, finishing up enrolling into the Belize Police Department at the training school. And my passion, the reason why I joined the department is because of the youths. The youths, that's the reason. And the thing is that I love about the Belize Police Department is that they gave me back that privilege to work with young people.
Now, what has the logistical aspect of it been like in terms of working up to this unfolding of the Black Initiative?
It's a lot of work. Yesterday I was in a meeting, our team, the PR team, was in a meeting with the officer in charge of Eastern Division, Ms. Phillips, in terms of updating her. And as you know, Mr. Braster is not in the city right now. He has actually assisting in terms of San Pedro with the recent spike of crime there. So we had to do like a phone conference. And it was, while that is one thing, the logistics itself and coordination is so much challenging, but what we have done is to work through the precincts. So to put a little support in it, that each precinct is in charge of their community, and they are the ones
so
to bring out the organization.
Shirt.
Yeah.
The
so they are in charge in terms to bring out the businesses, the organizations, whether it be schools, the churches, or any NGOs likewise. And also the young people in their community, each precinct. And we have a little incentive for that. The precinct who comes out with the most numbers, of course, their officers within that precinct will get a one-day R&R. So they can actually relax and rest that kind of way. And it's also a way of motivating them to be part of this with their community. So that logistical part of it is not much of a challenge for us from the PR unit. It's more of making sure the bigger picture of having that day goes smoothly. And of course, the logistics to start and finish. Cause we start at 7:30 in front of the Yaba Community Policing Center.
Yeah.
And we move off from there up Queen Charlotte onto the Port Authority Boulevard. And we move way up to the Hans Roundabout. We go into the highway itself up to the Western Avenue. And we come there. Turn down there into Mahogany, come all the way around, cross the boulevard again into Mopan Street, and we come all the way around. It's like walking in these hot spots.
You wanted to go through the hot spots.
Yeah.
Are you still stopping at the cemetery?
We're stopping at key points or key areas, and we'll spend at least 2 or 3 minutes there. We'll do some prayer there, and recognizing that these are areas that persons have been killed. And of course, we have, with PTO and the other police officers, have in invited persons who've literally lost their loved ones likewise. So we do have some people there participating who have lost their loved one in terms of crime and violence.
So what are you all expecting in terms of the participation? Are you not only expecting but encouraging people to, for example, bring pictures of loved ones that they've lost, that kind of thing? What kind of visibility are you looking at in terms of a structure to make this a reminder that a lot of life has been lost?
Well, we have, firstly, we look right now, our numbers are almost like 4,000 and 5,000 persons right now to participate. That's the number. Secondly, we've encouraged persons to bring out, we know that they have been walked before. Some persons have their shirts, they have pictures or posters of their loved one. Some of them, like the precincts, are putting together posters of positive messages in terms of stop the violence and cease the killing, with the whole idea of Black.
So we
have be loving and cease killing. So we have persons doing posters like that. In fact, there are some of the organizations doing their own t-shirts, like what PCPT have on right now. They have developed their own logo in terms of their printing of their business, but behind the shirt will have on the Black logo itself. So it's very important that we recognize the business for that. Certain organizations have literally, they have invested in their personnel.
Yeah.
For example, KHMH, Social Security, have literally said that their personnel will be participating in the walk. For different organizations who said that they cannot give all their personnel, we encourage them to wear white and Black for that Friday.
Yeah. Which is this Friday, March 27th.
March 27th. So we encourage people that if you cannot come and walk 7:30 in the morning, that basically they can wear their white and Black for the day in support and solidarity for the whole Black initiative that the police department is doing. We estimated that the walk will be more or less like two hours, 2.5 the most. We finish up at Battlefield Park. It's estimated like 6 miles we're going to walk. And after which we're going to provide a little snack and refreshment for persons. We're going to do a little rally in terms of the officer in charge of Eastern Division to give a speech, Mr. Brasta likewise. We have a couple of young persons who will give their testimony about their challenges in life and have literally gained from that. And then, of course, we have a young, dynamic group of artists who will sing a positive song out there in terms of their message when it comes to crime and violence.
What would you say is the direct objective that you're trying to meet with this walk?
Direct objective, of course, within the police departments, to build solidarity of the community and the police. We want to send a message to these communities, specifically these guys who feels that they can commit the crime anytime and feel like it's okay. We want to send a message to them that the community is here to send a deeper message that we do not tolerate these kind of behavior and of course actions from them. And we want to make it so clear that solidarity is what we want to do this in unity. It's not going to be just the police, it's going to be the community sending a message that we're not going to just sit on back and continue to take these occurrence of crime, whether it be robbery, be killing and stuff. We want to make these young men understand we are here as a community, and community we're going to stand strong.
Now, I can only
what's the tone that you all want this march to take? Because very often that's a part of the consideration as well. Is it kind of, you know, very sad, melancholic, you know, somber? Yeah. What's the general tone?
Well, yesterday we were at this discussion, and OCD said that, yeah, well, we are not going to like a funeral. We're going to be very conscious, so it's going to be very conscious about what we're going to do.
We're
going to have chanting. Of course, we have the young people, especially cadets, showing their things likewise, because we want a positive message being sent. In fact, we have some schools coming out too, so the schools will bring probably they're going to bring their marching bands likewise too, and drumming like that. We're sending that positive message. We're not.
But will
going,
it be
you know,
like soca music blasting from a box and people dancing?
No, we're not. It's not the soca message.
No, I'm just I'm just checking, because when we talk about tones, there are many ways you can go. So it really is just showing that there are thousands of people who will be at the march and others who support to say that we do not want this type of society and we will stand against it. And it's a quite an interesting time, because it probably means all the rest of the city will be at a standstill watching these thousands of people.
And you know actually how we, and the truth about it is a Friday, and the way how we've actually set up the
So you
the,
see,
the
you're
streets.
Very cognizant of the fact that you will be moving at a high traffic time. All right.
Yeah.
Okay, so employers can keep that in mind. Maybe that means employers can tell them, listen, just do the walk first and come to work.
Of course.
Right. Yeah, we're encouraging,
we're encouraging them to do so. I mean, of course, this is something very important. Crime have affected all of us, whether or not directly or indirectly. So as a business, it's very important to join us in this, because businesses do get affected, whether or not they get robbed or whether or not the personnel who participate, somebody get killed for them. Yeah.
Or tourism, the impact on tourism.
So we need everybody to come on board and support us in this initiative. It may not affect you now, but it will affect you later. Mm-hmm. So something like this is what we want to continue to encourage and continue to support, whether or not be the police leading it or police being supporting. Because many times we are the ones who are walking aside with those other groups who are actually walking in solidarity when it comes to crime and violence. So it's the first time we're actually leading and coordinating it.
And who have been some of your bigger supporters?
Well, I can see automatically we have KHMH who have given us support, Social Security. We have Mr. John Woods and the guys who are working constructions. Yeah. I could tell you immediately he have given full support to this, and all these young men who've literally been working on that project will be part of this likewise. We have basically communities, the schools have given their support likewise.
We have in Ramada Princess, we have big organization, different agencies. Mm-hmm. We have the Neighborhood Watchers. My colleague mentioned the business community. Those are the ones behind the scenes pumping the finance and the resources into it for this march to be a huge success.
And if people are still interested at this juncture to actually become a part of this initiative, how can they reach you, and what is there still room for that?
There's a lot of room. And first things, first, if within your precinct area, we're encouraging the businesses or organizations to touch base with the precincts. Each precinct, as I said, they're in charge of the community. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they can touch base with myself at the community, and the public relations unit itself, Raccoon Street. I have myself along with Rafael, the press officer, and of course, Corporal Hernandez, who assists us in the unit. You could also visit us there and share if you want to participate from the headquarters, because the headquarters itself will have a team. We are taking more or less like 300 persons just from the headquarters itself, and these are civilians and police officers that are coming from the headquarters. So while the precincts are in charge, and I think PTO is already at 2,500, almost 3,000 persons.
Oh.
Each precinct has an amount of persons that they are taking. So the headquarters, only fear that we take our amount, likewise, we have mustered up at least about 300 persons. So it's wherever the individuals want to come from, they can also visit the precincts or the headquarters, which is Raccoon Street.
All right, so the starting point at 7:30 is?
Community policing, Yabra.
Yabra on Caesar Ridge Road.
Caesar Ridge Road, yeah.
All right, so people definitely know where to go, and I'm sure they can jump in at any area as well.
Definitely.
The
definitely.
March is estimated to be, I think you said, 2 hours? Is that
2.5 hours.
Okay.
And we start at the Yabra, we finish at Battlefield Park. Of course, we walk from Southside, the whole eras, and then we cross into North Side, which is the North Front Street. We go through Pink Sally, through Victoria Street eras. We come around North Front Street.
All the hot spots.
Yeah, we're visiting this hot spot, and of course, we're sending the message clear.
Well, I think it's two things. You'll send message to the persons who are involved and those who live in the area who have become fearful and also stigmatized as well. So. It's an excellent initiative. We really hope that you are able to get more people come out and participate. And if you can't, of course, at least wear the colors in solidarity.
Yeah.
Well, gentlemen, thanks again for joining us.
You have bumper stickers.
Yeah,
as
we
well,
have
too.
Bumper stickers.
So people can.
Yeah, we'll again vehicles. Mm-hmm. We'll. Pitio mentioned to me that, for example, YWCA. They are going to bring out their young people and their staff, but also the teenagers. So you have some of them in the vehicles. So we're going to give vehicles the bumper stickers to stick on and show solidarity likewise. And of course, some people who can't come, they want bumper stickers and stuff. PCPTO at Precinct 3, they can contact him and get some of that. And likewise, businesses who are interested.
Is there
they
a cost to the bumper stickers?
Everything is free.
Everything is free.
Yeah.
The shirts are, the bumper stickers are. They just have to get contact with the precincts.
Okay.
All right. Thank you again, gentlemen.
Okay, thank you, too. Sure.
All right. We'll look out for what's happening on Friday. Of course, we'll be here on set, so we'll only be able to dress the part. But I wish you the best of luck.
Thank you. Thanks.
All right. We're going to go ahead and take a final break, and when we come back, we'll have our wrap-up, so stay tuned.